God's mercy is ever sure. We can leave our idols and reorder our priorities. We are empowered by God's steadfast love and faithfulness to become all we were meant to be. Sing a new song of praise to our God. Amen.
Started. Back up a She's from Ukraine. And her brother is a professional military army person. He is a commander of a battalion in Ukraine. So when the war started, we were trying to, they were lacking supplies, they were lacking ammunition, and we were trying to help. So we found a way to send it to them. We would send it on the planes with volunteers who flew to Poland. Each volunteer would fly with 60 suitcases. And then the people would, you know, meet the plane, pick up the suitcase and drive it into Ukraine, to Lviv, and then from there it would go where it was meant to go. And the problem that happened very quickly is that we ran out of suitcases because we just needed them to ship. The airplanes didn't want the boxes. So people in the city, they would go to TJ Maxx, to Marshall's, and it's still $100, you know, a big suitcase. And in the city, they have small apartments, they don't have attics, they don't have basements. So I said, no, let me try to get people to donate old suitcases, because we all have them. Like, I mean, we all bought new suitcases because they're so light and they're wheels, you know, and they all have those big ones. So to make a long story short, I got over 600 suitcases. And we would send 3-4 at a time, but then we were able to share with other people who were doing the same thing. So to make sure, it's not any kind of organization that's doing it. It's just private people who knew, had relatives or knew people in Ukraine and wanted to help. And so in the beginning, we were sending Kevlar vests and tactical gloves and night goggles because they just didn't have it. And so then other needs arose. So along with the suitcases, people were asking what else we can do. So it turned out that they didn't have, because in the front lines and basically in the trenches. So they didn't have a medicine, a Tylenol, you know, cough medicine. I mean, they still get itches and rashes and upset stomach, and they just don't have a place to get it there. So we started to send them. So, and other things that they were asking us to send. So then a couple of them got wounded, and they were sent to the hospital, field hospital, the new one that they started in Odessa. So it turned out that they don't have anything, so we were starting to send stuff there. But I would get donation from a doctor for boxes of little toothbrushes or toothpaste, and they sent it to them. They were very happy. So then this battalion I'm talking about, right, that my friend is a commander of, they liberated Kherson. I don't know if you heard that they went into Kherson that was under Russian occupation for a long time. So the other day, I'm talking literally 10 days ago, I'm talking to my friend about her brother. And she said, oh, the boys just went to the candy factory to get some candies for the orphanage. And what orphanage? So it turns out that, I don't know if you know, that the Russians, as a part of the basically genocide that's going on, are deporting children, kidnapping children and deporting them to Russia, Ukrainian children. So in Kherson, everybody knew that they were hiding children. Very famous, I was told you a story about this doctor of the hospital who invented children's hospital in Kherson, who invented all sorts of infectious diseases to prevent the Russians to come in. That was in the press here. And this orphanage, it's in a small village near Kherson. And when they were under, they hid children around at the houses, you know, neighborhood. And I was sent an email after the talk with all of this. And we have the footage of the Russians with guns storming into that orphanage, looking for children. And they seized all the documents, but there was no children. Anyway, no children were kidnapped and sent away. So that is the orphanage that we heard about. So when we were talking to Elizabeth before about your fundraiser that you do in the winter, and we were saying, like, where would the money be going? What would be, I said, no, we don't know. Let's find a way to see what the need is, because it changes as we go on. Like, now is the winter, we've been sending him those disposable hand and feet warmers, you know? that keep the heat for like 10 hours, and that was wonderful. So with, as time changes, the needs also change. So I have, we got into direct contact with the director of that orphanage, and we said, what do you need, like right now? Like, what's the most urgent need, you know? And he said, solar panels.
His solar panels, can you believe it?
Yeah.
All the things.
Because there is no electricity, and gas is hard to get. They have a generator, but it's expensive, and it's, you know, and she said, well, that means heat and water. Electricity means heat and water for the children. Because I was thinking clothes, but, you know, and they're like, you know, they've been dressed, you know, they might not have the best clothes, but they, you know. But this is like the most dire need that they have. So I'm just throwing it out there. We can do other things also. Of course, they need children's medicine. They badly need stationery for them, markers and pens, all things stationery that they have to have. They'd be very happy to have educational games. And children are girls to 15, just to let you know. Yes, of course, it would be great to have all those things donated, and I could make a list, and you know. But if you would consider, you know, the solar panels, they can also buy them there. And I think I was told that it's $500 for one panel. But we can, I can connect you directly to the orphanage. They have a Facebook page, I have the address, we have the email directly, and you can maybe take them under your wing a little bit and see what you can do.
Well, thank you, Nadia. We've put that challenge before us, so you're charming me of it. You know, we know it's a terrible situation over there,
yeah.
It's particularly affecting the children, and there's an orphanage needs help. Power of life, and maybe some other things that you've got to say.
Anything would be great. And if you don't have, and we're always looking for big suitcases. And if you don't have a suitcase, and you don't have extra money to spend, you can write a note, you know, to with support. Or you can ask the children to draw a picture. It's all fantastic.
Well, something we're hoping maybe some school will take ours, write some notes to send people the support we give.
To
be
let them know, because
yeah.
Putin's propaganda is saying that Americans are very angry that the government supports Ukraine. So everything we do from here, it really dispels it, you know? And I have incredible support of the community that is very generous and very supportive, which means that it isn't true. And you know, it's a big deal. It warms the heart.
Very complicated situation.
Yes.
I hope we're able to help out in some way. But thank you, Nancy,
sure.
For
thank
coming
you.
And sharing with us. And we'll see what transpires and what we can do.
Thank you.
So, thank you so much. And let's just say a little prayer and ask God to guide us into how we can help in these terrible situations. Let's pray. Lord, we are aware that there is need of your love in so many places. And there's children in Ukraine who are suffering because of the violence, because of the war, and we often feel helpless, we don't see a way into the situation, and yet this morning you've granted us an opportunity to help. And so may we rise to the occasion and discover practical ways to be a genuine help. Of course, we send our thoughts and prayers, but sometimes we also need to back up those prayers and thoughts with our actions. Help us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a second lesson this morning. It's from 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verses 1 to 9. Paul, called by an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth. To those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you've been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. May God add God's blessing to these readings from the Holy Scriptures. Amen. Even good churches have bad days. Corinth was a city located on this high plateau with about 4 miles wide strip of land that joined the mainland of Greece to another big bulge of land that sticks out into the Mediterranean Sea. And in Paul's day, it was really important because it controlled trade that was conducted along a road that passed by it, and across from the sea at two ports, one in the north and one that was in the south. It was a thriving economic centre inhabited by people from all over the Mediterranean world. And like port cities throughout history, it had a reputation of being a place where anything goes. What happened in Corinth stayed in Corinth. It seems a very unlikely place for the Christian faith to take root. And yet a series of missionaries had traveled through and left an impression, including the Apostle Paul. Now the first, second letters of Corinth were written by Paul to answer questions that the church there had about being a church and what was acceptable and what should change. Now, if Paul's letters to Corinth had consisted of chapter 1 and verses 1 to 9, our reading today, we might be left thinking, wow, what a church! Would be the kind of church we'd be hesitant to join because we'd probably spoil it. Paul speaks to them about being sanctified by Christ and how they were called to be holy. He praises them for being enriched in every way and talks about them being some great speakers amongst them and some people who were incredibly knowledgeable. And he describes them as full of grace. Now, in addition, their church was a place where there was all these spiritual gifts being given free expression, healings and prophecies, speaking in strange tongues and people interpreting what was going on. And in verse 9, he promises God will keep you faithful. He says he will keep you firm to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blameless. Sounds to me like the perfect church. It's only when you get past verse 9 that the trouble starts. I'm beginning today a series of sermons I wanted to do about the first three chapters of 1 Corinthians. And I'm calling it the Conundrums of Corinth and their legacy in the church. And I'm calling this first message, even good churches have bad days. But what are some of the things in coming weeks we're going to be thinking about? And these are things, you know, that weren't just happening in Corinth. It's got a kind of contemporary relevance to them. Disunity. Because the church in Corinth had been founded by different evangelists with different gifts and abilities, people had their favorites, and Paul was not always one of them, despite the fact that he was the person they wrote to when they needed help. And then there was pride. There were some knowledgeable people in Corinth. The trouble was, it made them feel they were superior to everybody else. And Paul takes them to task, and he starts talking about the foolishness of the gospel message and encourages them instead to humbly seek the mind of Christ. Shallowness was another problem. While some of them professed to know it all, others seemed extremely content, knowing very little. It was as though they just wanted to get by with too often. And Paul encourages them,
go deeper.
Immaturity. Paul really longs to teach them about some of the meatier things of the gospel message. But along with their shallowness, with some of them there was an element of childishness about them. Jesus taught the disciples, you know, to be childlike, not childish. And the church in Corinth seemed to get the two confused. And he complains, I have to give you milk, but really I'd like to be feeding you some steaks. I'd like to give you some meat instead. And then they had a problem with identity. The church in Corinth seemed to struggle to know who they were really meant to be and how that translated into the way that they lived their lives. And Paul talks to them, he says, actually, you know, you're a temple of the Holy Spirit. And if you really gave yourselves to serving other people, then you wouldn't be so worried about your identity. It wouldn't be such an issue for you. Now, I've ministered over the years in different churches and shared thoughts with many colleagues who have exactly the same task as I do. And it's so interesting how those themes crop up time and time again with regularity in so many congregations. They certainly were not conundrums unique to Corinth. But as he begins his letter, flawed as they may be, Paul looks at the Corinthian church through the eyes of grace. He begins by thanking God for them. He's thankful that they're even there. Establishing a Christian community at that time, in that place, was an awesome thing to have accomplished. He's thankful for their potential. He's thankful not only for what God had done in the past, but what God was going to do in their future. I mean, for sure there were things they needed to work at, for sure there were things that needed to change, and for sure there would be things he wouldn't praise them for. And in fact, this is the only section in the whole letters that he goes into a great deal about thanks. He knew, you see, he knew good churches have bad days without exception. Now here at Bridgehampton, there's so much I'm thankful for. I don't always get a chance to say that. I thank God for the opportunity of even being here. I thank God for each of you. I thank God, even when it's chilly, for my morning commute. It's beautiful. I just walk across from the manse and here I am. I thank God for the way you care about this building and the grounds around it. I thank God for our worship services and this privilege of being able to preach and lead in worship. I thank God for the music that we're provided with Sunday after Sunday. I thank God for the families here. No, we haven't got any today, but I love it when we see the families together in church. What a blessing. I thank God for those who teach and prepare our Sunday school lessons and brought to the nursery to care for us when the little ones are here. Thank God for our office and the staff and the volunteers who help out. I thank God for those of you who take care of our finances. Come up with reports week by week, set the budget. It's not a task you always get thanks for when you tell us how it is. I thank God even for our committees, our session, and our deacons. I thank God when I see people volunteering to, oh, I'll do the usher this week, oh, I'll help out with the fellowship, I'll help out in worship. I thank God when I see you reaching out to each other and showing concern for each other, and I thank God when we're able to reach beyond our walls, out into this community, and maybe even around the world. I thank God when I'm greeted with a smile by a child, or a handshake from the saint. I even try and thank God when I'm called to task for something that hasn't gone well. There's always something new to learn. I make mistakes. Guess what, people? I'm human. Look, I could make this a very long sermon full of thanks, but you might not thank me for that. So I'll quit while I'm ahead. But I will encourage you today, as we start this series, to do as Paul did and give some thought to things about the church that you're thankful for. Maybe go home, write a list, all the positives, all the things and experiences that you would not have had in your life if it were not for the church community. All the ways the church stands as a witness to the love of God. Oh, we know we can find things to complain about. And Paul had a whole lot of things to say about the church in Corinth. But he begins by lifting them up. Lift them up in his prayers and in his praises. And I encourage you, as we're still near the beginning of a year, do the same thing. This is a good church. You know that. And you need to hear that. And of course, we still manifest all the conundrums of Corinth. Well, that's how it is. That's how it is in every church. And at the end of the day, what defines a church isn't how perfect it is, how blameless it is. A church isn't defined by how large or small it is. A church isn't even defined by its strengths and weakness. Do you know what a church is defined by? Grace. A church is defined by grace. And even good churches have bad days. So if you're having a down on the church day, or feeling a little disconnected, or the things aren't going the way you would hoped, then remember, even good churches have bad days. And resolve, don't leave it there. Take it to the Lord in prayer so that you become part of the solution rather than part of the problem. Give thanks to the church. And after he's done that, he then starts to diagnose some of the problems, and Paul starts to offer graceful ways to travel through them. He talks about a faithful church. He says a faithful church is one that's willing to become more than it already is. It's got an amazing history, and it's been the spiritual home of some amazing people. But there's always more. Nothing stays the same, and we have a whole lot to build on. We owe it to those who laid the foundations to keep on keeping on. That's how we honor them. A faithful church, he says, is one that goes forward in faith. Notice Paul encourages us to go forward in faith. Faith not in our past, not even in our present abilities, but faith in God. Faith in Jesus Christ, who we're told is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Faith in the ability of God's Spirit to create beautiful things out of the common clay of human life. A faithful church is one that recognizes it's on a journey, but it hasn't yet arrived. See, the thing about being a pilgrim in this life is we never arrive. We're permanent pilgrims. We keep traveling till we reach our heavenly home. And we pray every Sunday that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that prayer acknowledges it hasn't happened yet. We're a work in progress until we reach our heavenly home. And a faithful church is one that's both thankful for her past and excited for her future. You know, some people that like sweep away history like it never happened. And everything came forward as a matter, we've got to build something new. You know, that wasn't the way of Jesus. And we talk in church about the new covenant because we recognize it was built upon something. It was built upon an old covenant that came before. But Jesus said he didn't come to do away with the law. He came to fulfill it, to show us what it was really about. You know, the great thing about traditions is they're like stepping stones. They give us a way through some of the difficult times, so we don't have to reinvent the wheel every time we have a problem. Of course, we can also become millstones around our necks, but that's only if we enshrine them and put them above what God's Spirit is doing at present. As in most things, it's all a question of balance. Finally, this, a faithful church is one that will acknowledge it's far from perfect, but recognizes God's still at midst, in her midst, working away. And that kind of brings me back full circle to where I started. Even good churches have bad days. We learn from our mistakes and we move forward. But it takes time. And it takes patience. And most of all, it takes overflowing love. And those things are a gift of grace. Paul thanks God for the Corinthians because God had given grace to them in Jesus Christ. And at the end of this thanksgiving, Paul reminds the Corinthians that God, who is faithful, called them into communion with one another and with Christ. And if you look back at that reading, you don't have to do that right this second, but in between every time he says thank you, Paul mentions Christ. His letter's written to a community, and God knows being a community can be incredibly hard work, particularly when the only thing often in a church that people may have in common with each other is a faith in Jesus Christ. And every single person is at a different stage of their discipleship journey within the grace of Jesus Christ. So, today, I'm just urging you, be thankful for your church. Recognize that even good churches have bad days. But don't make the bad things your focus. Rather, accentuate the positives. As Paul wrote to the church in Philippi, and this is from the Amplified Bible, Philippians 4:8. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable and worthy of respect, whatever is right and confirmed by God's word, whatever is pure and wholesome, whatever is lovely and brings peace, whatever is admirable and of good repute, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think continually on these things. Center your mind on them, implant them in your heart. So, in closing, I'll stay with those introductory verses of 1 Corinthians. We'll have enough time in coming weeks to get to all the problems Paul talks about. Even good churches have bad days. But for today, I offer you what Paul offered them. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. And to God's name, your honor, praise, and glory. Amen. Let's sing another song. It's hymn number 364. I sing the song of the saints of God. 364. life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, who alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and the least of the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raises Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. In life and in death, we belong to God. Amen. Please be seated. We shall receive our offertory. Because of your generosity, we have not lacked for anything. say hi to the first stranger. Wish them well. One brief announcement. The annual congregation corporate meeting takes place next week, immediately following worship. And all members are earnestly invited to attend. The annual report is going to be mailed out and by email this week, but there's also printed copies in the office if you would like to obtain a one. But let's turn to God with our prayers. Let's pray. Lord our God, we know it to be a truth that no matter how wonderful things can be, we still have to pass through difficult times. It's true in our personal life, it's true in the lives of communities, even in the life of our churches, even good churches have bad days. And the challenge, Lord, is to stay close to you during those times, to not let circumstances that are up close and personal sometimes define our relationship with you or our attitude to those around us, but to seek for our blessings in the light that continues to cast rays into the darkness and allow thankfulness to transform our thinking and our acting. We know there's those we share our lives with who are traveling through difficult days, sickness, bereavement, and tough choices and decisions to be made, unexpected challenges, unwelcome situations. We lift them up in prayer. In particular today, we think of folks known to us. We pray for Christopher, Joanne, Coral, Caitlin, Bonnie, Betsy, Polly, Peter and Eileen. We pray for our sister church in Guinness, Pastor Rodrigo and Isabel, who are ill with flu, and also for Calinac. We know all the nations go through times of constant transition and change. And we know that within those times you call your people to stand for mercy and justice, for grace and courage, for peace and for hope. And as we seek to remember Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., we seek that those sort of virtues will be lifted up, especially by all those in positions of leadership at national and local level. May all our relationships be transformed by your love, because it's a sort of love that accepts us once and all, yet is not content to leave us as we are, but tries to transform us into what we could be. The sort of love that grants a vision and a purpose to our lives, that reflects dimensions and values of your kingdom. We pray for your church throughout the world, in some lands under threat of violence or persecution, in others struggling against times of indifference or affluence. We pray for peace in our world, and particularly today we've been thinking of the land of Ukraine. But we know there's also other areas where peace and justice seem a long time coming. We're thankful that we, imperfect and conflicted as we are, still you call us to be disciples. So we're thankful for every encouraging word, every blessed friendship, every moment of blessing that has transformed our lives through the life of your church. And so we join in that family prayer Jesus taught his disciples to say, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We'll sing a closing hymn. will have to face. They faced them through grace. May we take the same attitude, the attitude of our Lord Jesus Christ. And let us go out in his name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let the people say, Amen. Amen.
Please join me in the closing response.